金啊！
迄地吼，我看你着爱规去牵只牛来煮烤我倒。
容易哦。
亲像伊来了，后摆阮陈老家是要安怎管人啦？
Hello.
Hi.
I am Martin Lucano, and Malformation Movie Post, and I am very honored to have director Wang Toon for our chat today. Wang Toon was born in Anhui Province, China in 1942 and moved to Taiwan with his family in 1949 after the communist takeover of the country. He attended the National University of the Arts in 1962 and began working for the Central Motion Picture Corporation, or CMPC, of Taiwan in 1966. He started his film career in the 1960s, initially working as an art director before making his directorial debut in 1981 with two films, If I Were for Real, and A Flower in the Raining Night. Wang worked as an art director and has since directed more than 10 movies and has been an art director for 54 titles across Taiwan and China. In addition to filmmaking, Wang has been a professor of film at the National University of the Arts in Taipei, Taiwan. In 2019, he was awarded the Lifetime Achievement Award at the 56th Annual Golden Horse Awards. This conversation will be as part of the Taiwan Film Festival Edinburgh 2021. And Hue of No Return is now available to watch on the online viewing platform. Welcome to Director Wang.
您好，我是亚洲电影脉搏的 Martin Lucknow。 我们今天很荣幸可以访问王童导演。王童导演于1940年出生于中国安徽省，1949年随家人到台湾。他于1962年就读于国立艺专，然后1966年进入中影从事电影工作。他是台湾知名的导演和电影美术设计，代表作包括了1992年的《无言的山丘》。电影背景是这部电影的背景是台湾的日剧时代。他于1981年开始执导电影，早期的电影包括了《假如我是真的》和《看海的日子》。他执导了十多部电影，也在中国和台湾担任了超过50几部电影的美术设计。此外，他也在台北艺术大学教授电影创作，培育下一代。2019年，王童导演获颁第56届金马奖终身成就奖的殊荣。本次的访谈是2021年爱丁堡台湾电影节所举办，《无言的山丘》也是本次影展的放映电影之一。我们非常欢迎王童导演今天能够来和我们对谈，欢迎你，导演。
谢谢。
Thank you for your invitation.
Thank you. Hue of No Return is the final film in what many critics and historians refer to your nativist trilogy, along with The Strawman and Banana Paradise. Did you intend these films to be part of a trilogy? If not, did you consider them to be part of one retrospectively?
无言的山丘被影评还有许多学者都视为是导演您的这个本土三部曲。那您在一开始拍摄的时候，是不是就设计让这三部 作品成为一个三部曲的一个系列，还是当初其实并不是这样子的规划的？那现在您又是如何看待这个大家对这个三部曲的定位呢？
一开始就是准备拍台湾历史，也就是有三个题材想在表达嘛，那我就列了一个时间表，就想从无烟山丘开始拍，也就是日本时代的大正年的年代，一直拍到昭和，就是稻草人，然后再拍到香蕉天堂，后面还有个红柿子，就三部到四部准备讲台湾史。可是这个无烟山丘的经费比较大，所以没有办法一下子就可以拍，所以提早先拍一部稻草人，比较经费少的，然后因为票房很好，所以再拍香蕉天堂，最后也不错，再回头拍这个无烟山丘。
At the beginning, I had in mind that I want to film something on the theme of Taiwanese history, and I had in mind like three different sources. So if we follow the timeline chronologically, at the beginning, I want to start with Hill of No Return, that's kind of earlier in the Japanese occupation time, and then moving to Strawman, coming to the end of the Japanese occupation era, then moving to Banana Paradise, and the following is the Red Persimmons. However, Hill of No Return was kind of bigger production and need more funding. So I wasn't able to do that as the first film. Instead, I started with Banana Paradise, Strawman, which is kind of small budgeted film. And then it turned out to be a box office success. So then allowed me to carry on with Banana Paradise, which again is another success. So that's why I moved from this order, as not how I originally planned chronologically.
And can you tell us what compelled you to focus on the films with the so-called nativist subject matter?
那导演您一开始的动机是为什么想拍这个台湾的这个本土的故事呢？
因为我以前拍过很多电影那以前的电影大概都是我们公司喜欢丢一个题材给我拍，我没有想法就是把它拍得好。后来我拍了一个看海的日子，黄春明的本土作家，那后拍完以后我觉得应该自己为这个台湾的这个上一百年的历史来做一点功课，所以我就停下来花了十年的时间去研究台湾的历史，我也到东京去找很多资料，十年的时间才规划出来拍这个台湾的三部曲，所以它的历史背景我很清楚，它的建筑、它的美术花了很多时间，所以就从那个时候想用十年的时间研究来拍台湾一百年的故事，一直从汉人来到台湾早期一直到了国民政府来到台湾中间有日本时代所以有日本时代的两部电影，一个民国三十八年的1949年的台湾的中国大陆的军队来到台湾，把这个把一百年的历史把它拍完。
Yes, so in my early career, I was involved in many films, but those were the topics that the company want me to film. It's not really my own choice. So.And then I had this opportunity to film A Flower in the Rainy Night, which is based on a novel by a nativist novel by Huang Chunming, a renowned writer in Taiwan. So after that, I start having the idea that I want to tell something about the 100 year of Taiwanese history. After that, I spent 10 years doing research on Taiwanese history. I even went to Tokyo to do the research. So, and that's really lead to what we see now, the nativist trilogy. So after this 10 years of research, I become very familiar, or I have a very clear idea of the Taiwanese history, how was the architecture like, how the art design should be like to representing those era. So these, so I spent 10 years doing research on these 100 years of Taiwanese history that covers, for example, from early Han people moving to Taiwan, then we went through the Japanese occupation era, so two movies was based on against the background of this era, and then moving to nationalist army moving to Taiwan in 1949. So that's basically what motivated me to focus on the Taiwan history.
And the characters in the trilogy you're speaking about are from poor rural communities, making them a bit removed from your own upbringing in China and in Taiwan. What made you choose to focus on them, and how did you approach telling their stories?
所以在这个导演您的本土三部曲当中，这个主角他们都是比较低下阶层的一般老百姓。那这个是不是跟您自己的成长背景其实是不太一样的？或者是说，那您为什么会选择这样子的小人物作为主角？那您又是从什么样的角度去讲述他们的生活呢？
我是一个军人子弟的哦，但是我小的时候就是跟很多小兵在一起，所以我很关注一般人的生活，哦，来到台湾以后呢，家里不是很富裕的，大概接触的人大概都是小人物，我看到很多台湾人或者大陆来的中国人都很辛苦，非常苦难的生活，所以我特别觉得这些人才是最有生命力的人群。真人电影我觉得是讲人，大众人的故事，而不是要有英雄啦，很多很多非常有剧情有戏剧性的东西，真正关心一般的很多好的故事，他们的心酸，因为历史的背景或者外在的压力，所以这才有真正的人的面貌。所以我就我觉得人最重应该关心这些人的故事，所以我才去听了很多小明的故事，每个时代的小明的故事。所以我觉得电影很多面貌了，我个人喜欢比较拍庶民小人物的故事，一直是这样的。
I come from a background of a military family. When I was a kid, I spent a lot of time with soldiers in the army. And so I like to focus on underrepresented or ordinary people in my film. When I moved to Taiwan with my family, we didn't have money. We were not wealthy. And I saw a lot of people in the same situation as me, whether they are local Taiwanese people, whether they are mainlanders coming to Taiwan, they suffer and they struggled, they had difficult life. But I think it's particularly this group of people, they represent the strength, the power of life, living. So I think a good film should focus on ordinary people, majority of people, rather than superheroes, or pay attention to the dramatic tension in a film. So I think these good stories have a historical background, which is difficult, or a turbulent chapter in a history. and people have pressure in the internal surroundings. But because of these, that really bring out the true color of people or the true face of people. So that's why I become interested in this particular group of people. And I like to listen to their stories, listen to their voices, and particularly the ordinary people in different historical eras. And I think in a film, you can present different aspects of life, but I like to focus on ordinary people.
That is what really drew me to Hue of No Return, this history of from bottom up, rather than presenting just the heroes or the soldiers or their stories or the stories of the ruling Japanese, and then not showing how the people lived. So I think that is incredible.
我也完全同意您的刚才说的，这也是我自己在这个无言的山丘里面看到的，在讲的就是在这个日本统治阶层底下的小人物的生活，这个也是让我很有感触。
讲到我喜欢的电影，大概世界上很多伟大的电影、好看的电影，大概都讲小人物。我想你们大概记得最有名的电影就是《单车世界记》，意大利这个，一个工人丢掉脚踏车的故事，有没有？《单车世界记》在世界上非常有名，所以很多不一定是好莱坞，很多好的电影都是在很多小的国家的产生，比如巴西，比如说伊朗，或者是。南斯拉夫或者是希腊、意大利，很多好的电影都是描写人生的，而不是真正好莱坞电影，那个才是动人的。尤其像小津安二郎他拍的《东京物语》，那一系列的关于庶民的压力也好，但我比较喜欢写这种故事。
Yeah, we can see this in some of the world's most famous movie as well. Like the films I like tend to focus on the stories of ordinary people as well. So like the famous movie in Italy, Stolen Bicycle. I don't know, Martin, you can correct me.
Bicycle Thieves.
Yeah.
I think in English it's Bicycle Thieves.
Okay, yeah. Bicycle Thieves. Yeah, so it focuses on a worker who lost his bicycle. So this kind of simple story is actually very touching. I feel that some of the greatest movies, they don't necessarily come from Hollywood. They come from other countries like Brazil, Iran, Greece, Italy. They all have very, very good movies, and they really touch you. And for example, another Japanese director I really like is Yasujiro Ozu. I like all his stories, his films focusing on the life in Tokyo. And again, this simple story, but very touching.
Yeah. You mentioned about researching the history of Taiwan and representing it in the movie. We can see this one in the art direction. So as we know, you have worked as an art director for a long time before making your own movies as a director. And in what ways has the work as an art director informed your approach to both to your trilogy and your whole filmography?
另外想要问的是，导演您在指导电影，就是作为导演之前已经有非常丰富的这个美术设计、美术指导的经验。那过去，然后美术也是您的这个专长，所以您过去这些美术设计指导方面的经验，是不是影响了您在拍片的风格，还有对于电影的独特的呈现方式呢？
他讲的非常有道理的，因为我是学美术的，电影很重要一个事情是空间，一个时间的问题，在空间跟人物这三个都要很合适的在一起，所以人物、时间、空间是我很重视。另外，我也喜欢研究色彩，或者是摄影的怎么样？摄影的深度，所以把这个空间人物放在一个合适的地点的话，非常重要。所以 场景是我很在乎的。
Yeah, definitely. My experience as an art director really, is really reflecting in how much I focus on the presentation of space, the spatial configuration. I feel that there are three important elements in the film: that time, space, and characters. So you need to integrate. You need to place characters, time, in space, in a kind of coherent manner. So that's how the three elements interact with each other is really what I really, really focus. And I also like to research on color. I also think it's you need to have a good understanding of camera, like the depth of field. That's the thing I also research a lot. So I think it's all about placing the right elements in the right space, and that's the key, the main element in my film, I think.
Many critics consider you to be both a new cinema filmmaker and a studio director for more commercial movies. How did you negotiate the artistic elements that you made, that made you part of the new cinema movement and the commercial ones?
所以许多影评将你认为您是这个新电影时期的导演，但是也是片场时期这个商业电影经验的导演，在两方面都很成功。所以导演，您是怎么在这个追求美学，然后反映社会的这个新电影？那另外一边呢，是在这个追求卖座还有商业成功的这个商业制作电影，在这两方面你怎么取得一个平衡呢？
这个很难平衡了。有的时候，我觉得票房是非常重要的哦，它的卖座很重要。但是卖座你有一个条件，就是你的故事本身要有情感，要有感动，要是真的。如果你为了卖座而加了很多卖座的元素，比如不必要的东西，不必要的枪战、飞车、打斗这些东西，爱情也是，它不真实的。所以我比较在乎是剧情里面的情感，人的情感情绪，当然情节很重要。一般的卖钱电影大概很重视情节，而忘记了很多细在的情感，真实的情感，所以有点离开了，离开那个真正的人的感觉。当然你可以卖到很多钱，可是那个卖了钱以后，观众有没有被感动到那所以很难平衡，非常的难平衡。
Yeah, I think it's difficult to achieve a balance. Of course, box office success is really important, but behind that, you do need a story that really tell human beings' feelings, that really touch the audience. I don't think it's a good idea, like in order to achieve the commercial success, then you add unnecessary things in your film. For example, have a lot of fighting, racing cars, or like all the melodramatic elements. If they are not necessarily essential in the film you want to tell. So I still think the feeling, the emotion you want to communicate to the audience is the most important element. For commercial film, commercial films place a lot of emphasis on the storyline, but they often ignore details such as the subtle feelings of ordinary people, and sometimes that makes the commercial film deviated from the real life, the real people. So Of course, it's good to make money to have box office success, but you really need to ask yourself, do my films touch the audience? Do my film touch the feeling of ordinary people? So yeah, it's really difficult to achieve a balance.
Thank you. The transformation and disruption are the curation themes for this year's festival, as our audience knows and director knows as well. It would seem that you're the perfect filmmaker to offer an insight into the changes and hurdles within the Taiwanese cinema over the years. You began working in the Taiwanese film industry in the 1960s, as I said earlier, and you've been involved in many important eras, like the healthy realism of the 60s or the new cinema of the 80s and 90s. What are the biggest changes and events that are the most important to you as an artist in the history of Taiwanese cinema?
所以我们本在立马台湾电影节的主题是这个转变与中断。那导演您在台湾经历过台湾电影的许多重要的时期，那你很早就进入这个中影开始工作，然后重要的时期像是60年代的这个健康写实电影啊，80-90年代的新电影您都参与其中，所以我们想问导演能不能谈一下，就是从您看到这个台湾电影一路以来经历过的转变啊，面临的挑战，有没有什么转变或者是什么事件对您来说是特别重要的？
艺术这个转变不一定是电影，绘画、音乐，都会改变的。那改变第一个最重要的事情，因为我们现在的人，因为数位的改变啊，科学的改变，人与人之间的距离立刻就影响啊，慢慢的世界都好像会走到一条路上去，啊，那个是好还是不好，我不知道，但是会忘掉你本身的，一个国家，一个历史的背景，你不同的那个感受是什么，感受是什么？这个有点不一样了。大家都现在开始数位开始都一样了，因为比如东京跟台北某个地方都很像，在美国也很像，穿的衣服也很像，生活习惯都很像，爱情也差不多，这些东西，那真正深入还是要有本身的差异性，就是所谓的，也可以讲一个民族的美学，民族的美学，也可以讲个人的美学，那现在少了一个。失去了你原来的美学，全世界都走到一个 model 里去了，那就是有点危险，那就有危险，这个是我的感觉。尤其年轻人的电影越拍影响越大，这个是有点担心。
Changes to happen in art is not only in filmmaking. You see the changes in music, fine art, for example. I feel that the digital media and all kind of scientific technical advancement do change the world, entire world in the same way. So the distance between people and people are more distanced from each other.And because of this general trend, I feel that the whole world is moving towards in the same direction. It's like we are in this global world. We are all living in the same way. We feel in the same way. People dress in the same way. I'm not sure if it's good or bad. It's difficult to say. But I feel that behind this global trend, peoplemay gradually forget their own historical root, and they forget that how each country, each nation, or each person may perceive or feel about things differently. So now you see whether you live in Tokyo, whether you live in Taipei, you probably tell stories in the same way. So I feel that.In order to have some depth in your narrative in the film, you really need to focus on the differences between people around the world. You may call it kind of national aesthetics or personal aesthetics, So I feel that it's quite dangerous. We have lost how we, in the past days, people from different countries may feel things differently, say things differently, but now we all fit in this one model. So for me, I think it's kind of dangerous, and particularly for the young generation when they try to produce their films. Yeah.
This idea brings me again about something I've thought about your nativist movies and nativist trilogy. First of all, I would like to ask you, has any of the books from the resurgence of nativist literature in Taiwan in the 70s and 80s influenced you? Or maybe music in the 90s, like more nativist bands that started, I think, appearing in the end of the 80s and beginning of 90s? Have they influenced your work, on, especially on Hue of No Return and maybe Red Persimmon?
所以导演您刚才谈到这个艺术它各方面都是互相影响的嘛，所以我也想要问一下导演，您刚才说您花了十年的时间去研究这个台湾本土的背景，那您在研究的过程中是不是也受到一些启发，比如说六七零年代的音乐啊，或者一些美术的作品，是不是有其他的艺术的方面影响了您对这个本土三部曲啊，还有接下来这个红柿子的这个电影的创作？
这个是一定的，你要拍一个以前的时间的故事啊，你要还原那个时代的所有的视觉上的问题吧，你要回到那个啊，那个要花很多时间去尽量揭示真实的啊，那个花很多时间，而且三部曲里面跨的时代也蛮长的。因为有一个日本嘛，所以日本本身也花了很多时间改变。大正年昭和前面是大正，大正的后来就战争，就昭和的日本也不一样啊，在明治跟大正之间的是一个样子，日本开始起飞变成强国，到了昭和大二战的时候失败了。失败以后就变成很多庶民的文化就出来了，那台湾夹在中间里面，你必须要了解时代，台湾时代的变迁的背后那一段的所谓的美学了，生活美学、建筑美学、服装美学都是按照那个时代的。后来国民政府又来，又一次改变，所以这个一直在改变。我要谈就是那个时代里面影响台湾电影比较深刻的是日本的昭和时间的电影，因为我们是被统治者的台湾嘛，所以接受日本的文化，所以昭和时代的电影影响我们这一代，比如黑泽明的电影，小津安二郎的电影啊，都是写日本，尤其小津安二郎很多电影都是写昭和时代的庶民文化，很像台湾那个时代的故事，所以我们被影响，时时刻刻的被影响，所以又回到那个时代的美学，寻找那个真实感的拍摄的所有的关系的美术也好，服装也好。所以文化的回过去，也就探讨那个时代的价值观了。
Yep, so definitely, in order to represent the what happened in the history, you really need to, visualize the scene, in that historical background. So, obviously, try to recreate a historical era, the buildings, the architectures, the costumes, everything's very time consuming. So I try to make them as real as possible. The nativist trilogy, span across a long period of time from, different eras in the Japanese occupation time from, until like the second the Second World War began, the Second World War end, Japan was defeated, and after they were defeated, and you saw emergence of like different popular culture in Japan. So all these things play a role in the design of the film. The changes are reflected aesthetically in the way you live, you dress, architecture style, for example. And later on, the national government come again, that brought another change to people's daily life. And I think the most crucial influence to one of the most important influence to Taiwanese film in this era are probably particularly represented in some film directors' work, in particularly like Akira Kurosawa and Yasujiro Ozu. So the aesthetics in their film, and also how they tell the story of ordinary people, has a great influence, and how values are presented in a film is really important.
As I said earlier, I really like the way you represent the story of the people. It's so touching, but at the same time, at least in my opinion, it's very close to the ideas of many post-colonial theorists, giving even a deeper layer to the stories you're touching, making your telling. They're both very touching, but at the same time, they feel political and very valuable, I believe.
我完全认同导演您说的。我觉得您拍摄的电影对我来说不单是非常感动，我觉得它还反映了社会的很多现实面。所以很像这个后殖民主义里面谈到的，您这个电影体现了小人物的心情跟感受，但是也反映了这个大时代它背后的政治还有历史的背景。
没错，就是说人很渺小，常常是自己不能做主，因为政治的问题等等的问题都危害了人本身生存的条件，就是外来的压力。他就尤其那个时代的人，他就是一种讲可爱嘛，也是无奈，因为无奈这个东西我不知道怎么讲，他就要活嘛，他要生存嘛，他都要接受嘛，但是他肚子里面就是不是很高兴了啊。所以你要探讨人活的真正的目的是什么，他应该快乐嘛，他自由嘛，可是外面的压力是你没办法改变，你是弱者，那就是小人物常常在想办法怎么活下来啊，想办法怎么生存下来，是很悲惨的，很可怜的。不是以前，你现在很多还有很多难民嘛，我们看到现在战争还有很多难民嘛，那这个就是当年一样的故事一直重演嘛，这个重演对人类是不好的了，但是它就会重新演，这就是人的本性的问题了。所以有高的压力就残害了很善良的老百姓啊，你懂我意思吗？所以电影最好一个工具就是替这些年轻人，这些苦难的人在电影里面说那些也不是抗议的，就是委屈的声音，在电影里面要表现，让观众想一想，或者大众反省，为什么要有这种事件发生呢？这个就是，所以电影有的时候是一个宗教，我觉得电影是一个宗教，它是一个信仰，是说好电影给别人看，让电影感动了人来反省我们做错了些什么。这是我的信念呢。
Yeah, so I indeed, if we look around, every person, individual human being are so small, we are so powerless, we can't not really control our own life because of all kinds of pressure, political suppression, for example, and all these external surroundings really threaten individual survival. So when you are in this kind of historical political background, in order to survive, you just need to accept whatever comes to you, fall upon you. Okay, then you may not be happy, you don't like the way you live, but what exactly is the purpose of living? Is it to be happy? Is it to be free? So I think it's just it's just what happened in ordinary people. Usually we cannot make fully control how we would like to live, but it's more just about to survive. Yeah, it may sound sad or it may sound a bit tragic, but this kind of thing does not only happen in the past. As we can see what happened in the world now, wars lead to refugees and people need to flee to another country. And this just history keeps repeating itself. We see the stories happen again and again. So maybe this is just something inherent in human nature, because this kind of pressure, the political suppression, usually is the impact is biggest on ordinary people, kind-hearted ordinary people who suffer the most. So to me, I see film as an effective tool, not so much to protest for these people, but to speak for them, or at least to show the audience how they suffered, how they struggled. And through this way, the audience may reflect on why such events happen and happen again. So in a way, I compare films with religions or even belief. It is through a touching film that you allowed the audience or people in general to reflect on the wrongdoings in the history or happening now.
I also think like that.
完全认同导演您的看法。
Your answer, I think, segues very, very well to our next section, which is some questions from the audience. We have a few. One of them is, as we spoke earlier, you've worked in the Central Motion Picture Corporation for a very long time. Have you yourself or have you seen anyone else being told not to do something due to political reasons, not to represent something or not to touch upon some story?
导演您的刚才这个回答刚好很顺的介绍下。 接到下一个我们观众的提问，因为您刚才提到小人物很多时候很无奈啊，然后外面有很多限制，很多时候你是没有办法做主的。所以这个观众的提问是说，因为导演您在这个中影工作的很长的一段时期，那有没有在什么时候，过去的时候啊，您自己或者是您有看到其他的导演或其他的同事，他想要做什么，但是其实上面告诉他说，你不能这样做，可能有
政治的因素或者是其他的因素，你的创作其实受到了限制。很多，我个人也是也经过，因为他会，因为他是一个中影嘛，他要宣传嘛，要教育嘛，要表达他们的政策嘛，所以他们选的题材，我们常常不是很喜欢，可是没有办法，因为你领他的薪水。 你要规规矩矩要拍出来，但是不要拍得过，改变了，所以会，所以我才有时间想我要重新来花10年来写台湾的历史，我从那边开始想做自己想说的故事了，就不太接受他们的要求了，会。
Yeah, indeed, there were a lot of constraints, and myself had that experience as well. Of course, the CNPC has it was created for a purpose. It has propaganda and has some educational purpose as a particular ideology they want to communicate. So very often I was given topics of the film that I personally, I didn't really like that much, but I had no other choice because I was the employee, so I had to do it. So it's precisely because of that experience that motivated me to start doing research. As I mentioned before, I spent 10 years doing research on the Taiwanese history, and I felt like I want to film something myself I'm interested in, rather than just accepting the topics they gave to me.
Yeah, and this is somewhat connected to the previous question. Have you seen also the creative freedom improved over the years, and in what ways?
所以接下来这个问题也是跟上一个有关的，就是那导演您经过这么多年来，你觉得台湾这个电影创作的自由有很大的改变了吗？然后有什么样的特别的改变呢？你想跟观众聊聊的。
我非常因为台湾现在开放嘛，不跟我们那个时代不一样了，所以电影就变化了，就非常好看了。因为谁都可以拍电影，谁都可以说故事，没有人在管你，只是观众喜欢不喜欢的问题，那你故事说得不好，人家就不看嘛。可是台湾有一个改变的元素，是因为我刚刚讲过，他是把外国的资讯都进来了。比如台湾有两个重要的影展，一个金马奖，一个台北电影节电影展，他每一年都举办的话，他把世界各地最好的去年的电影都放在台湾演出。那台湾年轻人喜欢电影的人口非常多，他不但要看台湾电影，他还看亚洲电影，更希望看世界各地方好的电影，所以他们对看电影的学习程度拉高了。所以他变成台湾自己的创作电影，它也比较不像我们那边我们以前拍的还有很多历史的背景，他们现在拍的电影比较合乎现代年轻的面对的辛苦也好，快乐也好，爱情也好，比较接近现代人。所以怎么讲，台湾的电影好像从一个毛毛虫突然变成很漂亮的蝴蝶，多样的蝴蝶。那个蝴蝶好不好不管它，但是它已经漂亮了，它也改变了，爬出来了。所以有好处有坏处了。那坏处是被外面的电影影响太大，失去本身的故事了。那好处就是说他看到世界了，不是台湾，韩国也是，日本也是，很多年轻电影跟我们完全不太一样了，但是也是蛮好看的，有的人说他没有深度，其实不见得，有的电影还蛮有意思的，所以是开放是一件很重要的事情，就是变成蝴蝶就漂亮了嘛。它埋在土地里面很久很久，突然就改变了。所以我们以前都是埋得很久，他们现在很快就起来，所以有很多好处了。
So the Taiwan film industry nowadays is really, really different from what it was before. A lot of restrictions are lifted, and you can see that a lot of very good stories are told by young directors now. So basically everyone can enter the film industry, they can produce their films, no one's going to tell them what to do or keep control on the topic they choose. Everything is up to the audience. If the audience like it, they watch. If they don't like it, they don't watch. So the decision is made by the audience. We also see the changes, probably the most significant changes that young people have more access to the films produced around the world. And this is particularly organizing two important film festivals in Taiwan. One is the Golden Horse Award and the other one is Taipei Film Festival. So in these two events, they showcase the best films around the world in that year. So young people, they learn a lot from these foreign films. They have a lot of sources to learn from. They watch films produced in Taiwan, in other Asian countries, particularly like Japan and Korea, but they also watch films just around the world. So the films in the past perhaps focus more on the Taiwanese historical background, but the directors nowadays, they focus more on the contemporary life. So it's closer to the life of the audience. So their happiness, their sadness, their love stories in the contemporary daily life. So I would probably compare Taiwanese film as a transformation from caterpillar to a very colorful butterfly. I don't know whether it's a good butterfly or bad butterfly, but it's colorful and it's very beautiful and it's transformed. Okay, they receiving a lot of, like having access to or exposed to foreign films, obviously have kind of positive and negative influence. So the negative influence might be like you try to imitate them too much, and at the end you lost your uniqueness of Taiwanese film. But on the positive side, you can see what other people are doing in Japan and Korea around the world. So this diversity in the Taiwan film industry overall, I think, is a very positive thing. Some people may criticize that nowadays some films are lack of death, but I feel like they are still interesting film to watch. They are good stories. So opening up to the world film is definitely has a positive influence on the Taiwanese film industry.
Yeah, we have another question for the audience, this time outside of the Nativist trilogy. We know that the director has also made animation and movies for children. I wonder what made you want to venture out in this field?
所以下一个观众的问题是，我知道导演您也拍摄了这个动画电影，还有给儿童看的电影。那你一开始怎么会想到这方面的拍摄这方面的主题呢？
动画电影就是小朋友爱看嘛，我们小时候喜欢看，而且动画电影可以把很多想法可以画出来啊。那个是很蛮有意思的哦，可是动画电影是全世界现在蛮流行的啊，不一定现在动画很多都是用动画做出来的，所以每个人都想动画片非常困难，比我们拍电影还要困难，因为它的资本太大了，花很多钱，所以我也想做，每个导演都想做一点动画片，但都很困难。所以到现在台湾的动画还是没办法那么发达的原因，就是说你想做但是结果都是不好的。一个是技术问题，主要还有一个说故事的问题。都不像这一点，就是迪士尼就很厉害嘛。所以这个地方我们距离很远。
So I produce animation because children like it. I love it when I was a kid as well. And I also think this process of visualize the story is a great fun. And this is a trend in the world, not only in the proper animation film, but this technology is really behind a lot of films nowadays. But the challenge is that you need a lot of investment because they are expensive. many directors want to film animation or use this technology, but it's just not possible because it's too expensive. I feel that the animation is still in an early stage in Taiwan. It's because of the challenge in technology, in investment, and also how do you really present a very fluent storyline? So there is still a long way to go. Disney films obviously are very good at that, but for in Taiwan, I think we still have a lot to learn from.
Another question from the audience is, other than the so-called nativist trilogy, which film of yours would you recommend for us to see and why?
Okay, so 下一个问题是导演您拍摄了那么多电影，然后这次我们就是特别强调的是这个本土三部曲，那还有没有哪一部电影或哪几部电影是导演您特别想要跟观众推荐说你们一定要去看的？
我想那个吧，我以前拍过两部电影，票房不是很好，可是我个人喜欢，也后来放映有啊，现在在中国大陆的有一个网络评分很高，就《红柿子》，一个很轻松的一个家庭故事。另外我拍一个《风中家族》，我个人也觉得也蛮好看的啊，大概是这样子。我顺便对不起，我想讲一个，就是说我后来教电影教了十几年，我最后给学生讲，电影不要再看的很多，不一定要量大，一定要看到最好的电影，就经典的电影啊，每个类型电影你要选几部最好的电影，永远记在脑，那个是宝藏，经典就是永远不会失去的，所以好的电影一定要去在里面去探讨里面那个伟大的导演他的不管技法他的思想，所以电影不要多，一定要很精致的几部重要的电影，世界上很多伟大的导演的电影必须要看。
Yeah, so there are two of my films that I would like to recommend to the audience. When they were released at the time, they were not particularly successful in terms of box office, but I personally like them a lot. So the first one is Red Persimmons. The story is quite relaxed and in fact it's quite highly rated in the webs in some of the websites in mainland China, so the audience nowadays really regard it highly. And another is Where the Wind Settle, produced in 2015. So if you ask me, these will be the two films I would recommend. And I just want to add that I have been teaching films in university for more than for several decades. And something I often share with my students is that when you watch films, you should focus on quality, not quantity. Not that you need to watch a lot of films, but you should choose the best films. So in each genre of the film, you can identify a few classics in each of them. So you watch the films by the greatest directors in the world and you learn from them. So classic film, not like a lot of films. So that's something I share with my students.
And we have one more question from the audience. We spoke that critics consider you as a new cinema director, but do you personally feel as part of this movement?
Okay. 所以在这个问题是我们刚才也提到，就是影评啊，还有学者，就是把导演就是认为是这个新电影时期的一个重要的导演之一。那导演您自己是怎么看这个定位呢？就是您觉得您是属于这个新电影时期的导演吗？
应该不是，因为我应该不是， 应该那个新电影那个时期，刚好我也在那个时间在拍电影，可是我们的想法是不一样的，我说的故事是不一样的。我们比他们所谓新导演比较大四五岁，所以我想讲的故事就是庶民的故事，平民的故事，他们归在那个时代，但是我们的那个方向好像不一样，也可以是那个时代，但是类型不一样啊，也没关系，也没关系，每个人的风格不太一样，
I don't think so. So I probably is the time overlaps. So I'm also producing film in that time when in the new cinema era. But I feel that we produce different kinds of film. The stories we want to tell are different. I'm a bit older than the other films directors by 4 to 5 years old. So I focus on, as I said, the stories of ordinary people, the underrepresented. So I guess it's just about the time happened that we work at the same time. But I don't really mind you. You can call me a new cinema director as well. But yeah.
Sorry, there's one more question. Just the questions come coming and coming because what you say is very interesting. We've seen some Taiwanese TV series have been seen globally. I'd like to ask you if you have any suggestion about promoting Taiwanese film to the world.
Okay, 最后再问导演您的问一这个问题，观众的问题一直进来，就是。所以这个是想问导演说，现在台湾有很多影视作品啊，都在国外，就是推广到国外的，让世界的观众都可以看到。那导演您对于这个推广台湾的电影到世界，有没有什么样的想法？就是觉得说，哎，台湾的电影导演可以怎么做？
因为台湾导演有几个很重要，比如李安嘛，哈，大家都认识李安，他是在美国纽约发展出来的。他电影很好看嘛，台湾现在也有很多好的导演，要靠什么？要靠影展，市场不会买台湾电影，不会拿钱买你的电影，可能在网络上可以买一点，真正好的电影一定要在世界各地的影展演出，从影展开始慢慢影响大。所以什么影展都要希望年轻人参加，总有机会被人家看到，而不是去影展得奖，并不是要得奖，是要开发你看到很多台湾好的电影，让他们慢慢看到，不一定要每个人都是变成李安都要得奖。拍电影到影展不是去得奖的，是让很多人看到，很重要。
Yeah, so Taiwan, one of the most renowned Taiwanese directors is probably An Li. So he's based in New York and his films are really good. Now we have a lot of new and young directors in Taiwan as well. I think probably the most effective way to promote Taiwanese film to the world is through the film festivals around the world. I think you cannot rely on the markets. People are not going to come to Taiwan and buy your film. You need to introduce your film to the world through film festivals. And from there, people start knowing about you.And then maybe the impact will follow on. So I often encourage young directors to go to film festivals around the world as much as they can. The point is not receiving a word. It's not that you go to a film festival, you want to receive a word. Not saying that everyone needs to become An Li and to win a word somewhere, but the main purpose of going to film festivals is go there to showcase your film, people watch it and they know about you. I think that's the most effective way of promoting Taiwanese film.
Thank you. I think that's sadly all the time we have for now. I would like to thank director Wang and of course our interpreter Michelle, and also to say thank you to our live audience. You can watch Hero of No Return and a strong lineup of Taiwanese film online at the platform of Taiwan Film Festival Edinburgh until the end of today. Thank you.
啊，非常感谢导演今天接受我们的访问，然后我们也要感谢今天参与我们的线上的观众，然后再次提醒大家，如果大家还想看这个无言的山丘的话，放映到今天结束为止，所以大家赶快去看。啊，再次谢谢导演。
好，谢谢。